first speaker is Sigal Rong. She's going to tell us about combinatorial options with endowment.
Thanks, Anik. So this is a joint work with Moshe Babayev and Shahar Dobzhinsky. Let me start with some background. So the underlying assumption in most of the works and works in traditional game theory is that the players, the individuals, are rational and they maximize some utility function. Behavioral economics posits that is not necessarily the case. In many cases, people have cognitive biases, and these cognitive biases make them behave irrationally and sometimes make choices very differently than in the utility maximization model. A recent line of work brings together algorithmic game theory and computer science with behavioral economics. Now, so far, the main focus in this line of work was about biases that have negative implications, and we're trying to quantify these implications and mitigating them. In contrast, today, we are going to see that sometimes taking behavioral biases into account may actually help. And we are going to talk today about endowment effects. So the endowment effect was termed by Richard Taylor in a really seminal paper in 1980 introducing several cognitive biases. And it basically tells us that once we own some item, we ascribe a higher value for it. The first experimental validation of this effect was done by Knetch in the University of Victoria in 1989. And he did the following experiment. He took some class of econ students and gave half of the students a coffee mug and the other half a chocolate bar. After the students received the goods, then they needed to fill out some questionnaires, and then they were asked the following question. Do they want to keep the good that they received, or do they want to exchange it for the other one? So 89% of the mug owners said they want to keep the mug. The mug is green, it's nice, they like it, they want to keep it. And a similar thing happened for the chocolate bar owners. 90% of them said that they want to keep their chocolate bar. It's tasty, it's nice, they want to keep it. Now, this could hint that if you look at the general student population, about half of them prefer mugs and half prefer chocolate bars, and this is actually the picture you get when you ask students who didn't receive anything. But the students here were partitioned into these two groups at random, so it's highly unlikely that all the mug lovers were put in one group and most of the chocolate lovers were put in another group. And here is another example of this effect. And this is an experiment that took place here at Cornell. Now it was a low in econ class, and half of the students received this Cornell mug, which you can go buy at the Cornell store, and half didn't receive anything. Now the students who received the mug were asked, how much are they willing to sell the mug for? And the median price, they said, was 5.25. Versus the students who didn't receive the mug were asked how much they were willing to pay for this mug. And their median price was 2.25. So there's a large gap between these two numbers. And this tells us that just the possession of an item, just the possession of the mug, immediately increased its value for the people owning it. Now let's discuss combinatorial auctions. So on combinatorial auctions, we have N bidders, M items. Each one of our bidders has a valuation, ascribing a value of each subset of the items. So here, Mario and the princess are our bidders, and the pictures are our items. Mario has an additive valuation. He values each picture at 600, and both at 1200, and the princess has the unit demand valuation. And we're going to be interested in a Wallerian equilibrium. So Wallerian equilibrium is composed of two things. First of all, we have an allocation of the items to the players. So for example, Mario gets this picture, and the princess gets the Andy Warhol picture. And then we have prices. And we are looking for prices such that each of the bidders is going to be happy with the bundle he received. So for example, Mario has an additive valuation, and he didn't get the Andy Warhol picture. So in order for Mario to be happy, the picture of the Andy Warhol picture, Andy Warhol, has to be at least 600. And since the princess is indifferent between these two pictures, this means that the price of picture A also needs to be 600. And it's not hard to verify that these allocation prices are indeed a Wallerian equilibrium. So let me be slightly more formal about it. So combinatorial auctions, as we said, N bidders, M items. Each bidder has a valuation function, VIS, giving a value of player I for a bundle S. And we assume these valuations are monotone. N normalized, the value of the empty set is zero. We define the social welfare as simply the values of all the players for the bundles that they received. and the optimal allocation is the allocation maximizing this objective function, the social welfare. Now, as we've said, we'll be interested in the dual-regional equilibrium. It's composed of two things, an item price vector giving a separate price for each one of the items, and allocation of the items. And for simplicity, we assume that all the items are allocated. So this is a partition of the items. And these two are dual-regional equilibrium if every bidder gets a profit-maximizing bundle. That is, the profit of bidder A from the bundle he received is at least as large as his profit for any other bundle. Now, this notion of dual-regional equilibrium is not only very simple and intuitive, but it's important because of the famous first welfare theorem, which tells us that if a dual-regional equilibrium exists, then the allocation it supports is socially optimal. And let's see another example. So now we consider budget added evaluations. These are evaluations where each player has a value of for each of the items separately, and his value for a bundle is the minimum between the additive value of the items in this bundle and some cap, which we call a budget, some cap B. So for example, Mark's valuation for the bundle consisting of all three items is 2,000, his budget. And again, we will be looking here for a dual-regional equilibrium. The first welfare theorem tells us that we only need to consider optimal allocations. So here is one optimal allocation. There's another one which is symmetric. And let's see if there are prices supporting it. So let's start with Luigi. Luigi has a value of 0 for the picture C he received, so the price of this picture has to be 0. The princess is indifferent between B and C, so the price of her picture also has to be 0. And now, Luigi's current profit is 0, and his value for picture A is 900, so in order for him to be happy, the price of picture A, of the kid hanging picture, has to be at least 900. And here we face a problem, since now the profit of Mario is 1,100, and he could increase his profit by taking instead a bundle of B and C, which has a value of 2,000. So in this instance, there is no dual-regional equilibrium, and in general, Gordon and Stacchetti have shown that dual-regional equilibria is guaranteed to exist essentially when the valuation belongs to a quite restricted set, Gauss substitutes. So for example, if we take valuations from budget additive class, or even the more general submodular class of valuations, then we are not guaranteed that the dual-regional equilibrium always exists. There are some approaches taken to overcome it. This includes some relaxation of the concept of dual-regional equilibrium. But we are going to take a different approach. So what we are going to do is add in the assumption that our bidders have endowment effect. And once we give them items, once we give them a bundle, suddenly they ascribe it a higher value. They like it more. Formally, after receiving a bundle SI, bidder I is going to value it a factor of alpha greater than 0 more. And as large as the alpha, as large as the extent he has an endowment effect. So we denote by VI, SI alpha T, the value of bidder I who received bundle SI and has an endowment factor of alpha for bundle T. And here we multiply by alpha the value of all the items he already owns, so the items in the intersection between SI and T, and add to this the marginal contribution of the race of the items in T. And if we rearrange, it will be easier to work with, we get that this equals the original value of the bundle T plus alpha minus 1 multiplied by intersection between SI and T, the items that that player I owns. And let's see an example. Again, Mario has a budget additive evaluation. His budget is 2,500. And let's say he owns the kid hanging picture, and he has value of alpha equals 2. So how does this change his valuation? His valuation for the kid hanging picture is simply going to be doubled because he owns it. His valuation for the Andy Warhol picture will remain the same. And his valuation for the bundle consisting of both pictures is going to be 4,500. So the original value of this bundle is 2,500, and there's an extra kind of bonus of 2,000 because he already owns the kid hanging picture, he already really likes it. So let's go back to the instance we discussed previously, and recall that in this instance we've shown that there is no dual-regional equilibrium. Let's see how things changes once we have endowed valuations. So we're going to consider the exact same allocation, and alpha equals 2. And with endowed valuations, we will see that even if we price each item at the value of the players receiving it, this is going to be already in equilibrium with respect to the endowed valuations. So, for example, with endowed valuations, Mario's value for the kid hanging picture is 4,000. Its price is 2,000, so its current profit is 2,000. And it's not hard to see that his profit for any other bundle is going to be less than this. And similarly for the princess. And the fact that we were able to do this is not just a coincidence. Our main result tells us that for some other valuations and any value of alpha, which is at least 2, an endowed equilibrium is guaranteed to exist. So let me define things more formally. So we discussed the model of valuations, and this is basically you can think about decreasing marginal utilities. And our definition of an alpha endowed equilibrium is the following. An allocation of the items A1 to AN and price vector P are alpha endowed equilibrium for some valuations VA1 to VN if and only if the same allocation and price vector are already in equilibrium with respect to the endowed valuations. So we change the valuations according to the items that the bidders received. And now this is a valuation equilibrium. And our theorem tells us that if all valuations are submodular, every local optimum is a part of the two endowed equilibrium when we price each item according to its marginal contribution to the player who received it. Now, there are a couple of interesting things to note about this theorem. So first of all, it really extends the class of valuations for which an equilibrium exists. Previously, valuation equilibrium was only guaranteed to exist for gross substitute valuations. Now we extend this to some modular valuations. Secondly, for valuation equilibrium, the only allocation that could constitute of such equilibrium was an optimal allocation. And here we also extend this, because now also locally optimal allocations, so these are allocations that the social welfare cannot be improved by moving one item from one player to another, these kind of allocations can also be supported as equilibria. And the last thing to note here is that the price structure we suggest in this theorem is really simple and intuitive. It's really something that you can easily compute by hand. Versus when discussing valuation equilibrium, in many cases, computing the prices by hand is kind of a difficult task. So let me tell you how we prove this theorem. So we have two steps. We show that for every bundle T, first of all, player I weakly prefers to add all missing items from T over T. So he prefers the union T and OI over any bundle T. And then we show that player I actually prefers OI over any superset of OI. And these two claims together tells us that player I always weakly prefers OI. So this is a Lagrangian equilibrium. The second claim is simply from the fact that valuations are submodular and our choice of prices, so we're going to skip it. And I'm going to tell you how we prove the first claim. So we want to show that for any bundle T, player I weakly prefers to add any missing items from OI to this bundle. And let me just remind you the definition of endowed valuations. So this is endowed valuations for a player who received OI and alpha equals 2. And this is the original value of the bundle T plus the intersection between all the items that the player already owns and T. So what we need to show is that the profit of player I for this bundle for adding the missing items from OI is at least as large as his profit from bundle T. Now we can omit the prices of the items that appear in both sides of this inequality and we get this. And just by definition of endowed valuations, we have that these two are equal, this is just the same, this is again the definition. And now by rearranging, we get that what we need to show to prove this claim is that the sum of prices is at least VIOI minus VIOI intersection T. Now let's recall how we price the items. So we price each item L at his marginal contribution to player I. Now, since our valuations are submodular, the sum of individual marginal contributions of the items is less than the marginal contribution of all of these items together. This is just by submodularity. And by definition, this is the same as this. So this is exactly what we needed to prove. So we showed that for the class of some model evaluations and alpha equals 2, any local any location which is a local optimum is an endowed equilibrium when we price each item according to its marginal contribution. And our proof basically suggests to define the following concept of endowment gap. So the endowment gap of a class of evaluations is the minimum value of alpha for which an endowed equilibrium exists. And the corollary of our proof is that for submodel evaluations, the endowment gap is at most 2. Now, a natural question is whether this is tight. So in some sense, it is tight. So again, recall that with Lagrangian equilibrium, we only consider optimal allocations. So if here also we only want to consider optimal allocations or locally optimal allocations, then we do have instances in which alpha equals 2 is required to support any endowed equilibrium. However, in these same instances, there are other allocations, not necessarily optimal, that can be supported for a low value of alpha. So in general, for supporting an arbitrary allocation, we have a lower bound of 1.5 on the endowment gap. So there's an open question here, where is the endowment gap exactly between 1.5 and 2? So what about more general evaluation classes? For functionist subadditive evaluations, XOS, we know that the endowment gap can be unbounded. Let me say a few words about connections to the LP. So this is the linear program for computing an optimal allocation in a combinatorial auction. And it is well known that the Lagrangian equilibrium exists if and only if the integrality gap is 1. Now, in the paper, we observe some interesting connections between the endowment gap and the integrality gap. For example, we show that the endowment gap is at least the integrality gap. Now, quite often, there's really a large difference between these two numbers. So for example, for XOS valuations, we know that the integrality gap is a small constant, but the endowment gap can be unbounded. So let me summarize. We've seen how introducing cognitive biases, namely the endowment effect to combinatorial auctions, really increases the size of class for which valuations for which equilibrium exists. And there are several interesting open questions. We already discussed the question of determining the endowment gap for some model evaluations, where it is exactly between 1.5 and 2. So for Lagrangian equilibria, Garland and Stacchetti have shown an ascending auction that ends in Lagrangian equilibrium. Is there a similar counterpart for endowed equilibrium, some ascending auctions, auction ending it? And lastly, so far, we didn't really discuss the computational aspect. Another question is whether we can efficiently compute an endowed equilibrium, or more precisely, what is the minimum value of alpha for which we can actually compute an alpha endowed equilibrium? What we do know is that our algorithm for two endowed equilibrium and some model evaluations is not computationally efficient. So both in our paper and in follow-up work, we've shown that it was shown that under different complexity models, computing a locally optimal allocation with some model evaluations is hard. So this is not probably not the way to go, but maybe there are other allocations that we can efficiently compute the allocation and the prices. So that's all. Thank you.
Questions?
The notions are somehow related, but there are no formal connections. These are two solution concepts, different solution concepts, but there is some similarity in the essence, yeah. Yeah.
Is there any bound on the welfare that could possibly be supported if it's down? Like you said, it's possible that it's not optimal, or possible that it can be very far from optimal?
So we do know that an alpha endowed equilibrium will give an approximation of alpha, but yeah, so that's what we do. Yeah. Any other questions? Yeah.
So in your model, the endowment means that you give somebody some item that certainly falls in the other. But say something, you start with the items of participant amongst
So asking kind of like what happens, what is the opposite question? So you begin with an allocation, what is the alpha supporting it? Yeah, so this is also an interesting question. We do know that you that are some allocations that you cannot support at all, that there is no alpha for which this is going to be in double collision, but yeah, you can also think about these kind of questions. It has to do with items that has marginal contribution of zero for one of the players, and then you can't really price them. So formally, you can't do it. Maybe there's a way to kind of change the definition. Sorry. So this would be possible. So, yeah. Any other questions? Okay. Thanks.